In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the line shape and line width. So this topic is a general topic and it is not specifically related to laser. So first of all, we know that every excited state has a certain lifetime, as we discussed that the normal excited state has a lifetime of about 10 power minus 8 seconds. And we also discussed that a metastable state has a lifetime of the order of 10 power minus 3 seconds. So lifetime of the metastable state is greater than as compared to that of the normal excited state. So as we know that every excited state has a certain lifetime. So according to the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, so what does Heisenberg's uncertainty principle states? It states that uncertainty in energy times uncertainty in time. Product of these two uncertainty is of the order of h cut. So delta E, which is the uncertainty in the energy, times delta T, which is the uncertainty in time. Multiplication of these two uncertainties is of the order of h cut, where h cut is nothing but h divided by 2 pi and h is the Planck's constant. So we know that every excited state has a certain lifetime. So as I have drawn normal excited state and I have drawn a metastable state. So these two states, they will have a certain lifetime of their own. That is, it is the time for which the atoms remain in that state before decaying to the ground state. So there is an uncertainty in time. And uncertainty in time is nothing but the lifetime of a state. So according to the uncertainty principle, due to the uncertainty in time, due to the lifetime of a state, there is an uncertainty in energy. So according to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, the excited energy level has a certain width, and width is nothing but the energy spread. So width means we have an energy spread. So due to the lifetime of excited state, of any excited state, we have uncertainty in time, and due to this uncertainty in time, we will get an uncertainty in energy. Means these excited levels, these are not exactly sharp, they are not perfectly sharp, but there is a certain spread in the energy. As you can see that I have not drawn a straight line. So earlier in the previous lectures, I had drawn a straight line, but in actual practice, we do not have a perfectly sharp excited state, and that is because of its lifetime. So there is an uncertainty in energy. So actually there is a band. So there is not a sharp line, there is not a sharp energy level, but there is a band. So there is an uncertainty in energy, and this is equal to delta E. So this uncertainty in energy, so this region, these all energy states, they come under one excited state. So this excited state is not a perfectly sharp excited state, and that is because of its lifetime. Due to its lifetime, we have uncertainty in energy according to the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So there is a band. So it is not a straight line, or you can say it is not a sharp, perfectly sharp line, but there is a spread in energy, or you can say there is a width. So the excited energy level has a certain width. Excited energy level is not sharp but has a certain width, and that is nothing but delta E. And the similar thing is for the metastable state. As I have drawn over here a metastable state with energy E1. So for the metastable state also, we know that there is a lifetime. Due to the lifetime, we have uncertainty in energy. So uncertainty in energy will also exist for the case of metastable state also. And due to this thing, when you will solve for delta E, so delta E for the case of delta E, for the case of metastable state, it will come out to be very less as compared to delta E for normal excited state. As you can see that I have shown uncertainty in energy for this level is more as compared to that of this level. So this energy spread in the metastable state is less. And this is because the lifetime of the metastable state is greater as compared to the lifetime of normal excited state, due to which the spread in energy for normal excited state is greater as compared to that of the metastable state. And over here I have shown the ground state, and we know that ground state is a stable state and it has a lifetime of infinity. So it has infinite lifetime because atoms stay there for infinite time until and unless there is external stimulation, the atoms will remain in the ground state only. If there is a photon, if we make a photon of energy equal to the difference of these two energy levels, if we make a photon of certain energy to fall on the atoms, only then these atoms will go to the excited state. Otherwise, these atoms, they remain in the ground state forever. So the lifetime of the ground state is infinity, due to which delta E for the case of ground state is zero. So delta E approaches to zero for the case of ground state. Therefore, I have shown a perfectly sharp level for the case of ground state. The spread or the width of the energy level, that is delta E, the spread or width of the energy level is more if the lifetime is less. So if lifetime is less, delta E will be more, and vice versa. So this we have already discussed. As the lifetime of the metastable state, is greater as compared to the normal excited state, therefore the width, the spread in energy for the case of metastable state will be less as compared to that of the normal excited state. So as we have shown that there is a spread in energy for the case of normal excited state also, as well as for the case of metastable state also, there is a spread in energy. Now, as we were discussing in the previous lectures, like if we have two level oscillator, the atom will go from the ground state to the normal excited state by absorbing a photon of certain energy. So this atom will absorb a photon of a certain specific energy only, and energy of this photon must be equal to difference in the energy of these two levels. So the energy of the photon must be equal to E2 minus E1. Only then this photon will be absorbed by this atom, and this atom will go to the excited state. And similar is the thing over here, that this atom, when it will go to the ground state, either by spontaneous emission or by stimulated emission, when this atom will go to the ground state, it will emit a photon of energy E2 minus E1. But over here we have shown that there are not perfectly sharp levels. The energy levels are not perfectly sharp, but there is a spread in energy. Therefore, these photons are absorbed over a spread of frequency, over a range of frequencies. Since these energy levels, these are not sharp, these are not perfectly sharp. So if atom is in the ground state, this atom can absorb a photon of energy, this energy minus E0, and this atom can also absorb a photon of energy, this minus this one. It can also absorb energy, this minus this one. So there is a range of frequencies over which the photons can be absorbed, and this occurs due to the spread in energy. Firstly, as we discussed in the previous lectures, we had drawn perfectly sharp levels. Therefore, we said over there that photon which is absorbed must be of a certain specific frequency only. Only then this atom will absorb this photon and will go to the excited state. But as we are discussing the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, due to this, we have a spread in energy. Therefore, photons are absorbed over a range of frequencies. Due to this spread in energy, due to this delta E, the photons which can be absorbed or can be emitted. So there are both processes that go simultaneously. So the photons which are absorbed, so this atom can absorb a photon of energy, this energy level minus this energy. So it will go to the excited state. So atom will absorb a photon of energy, this minus this, and it will go to this energy level. Also, another atom can absorb a photon of energy, this minus this one, and it will go to this level. And similarly for the third atom, the third atom can absorb a photon of energy, this minus this, and will go to the excited state. So atoms, they can absorb photons over a range of frequencies. And similar is the thing with emission process. So let's say atom is in this energy state, it will go to the ground state by emitting a photon of energy, this minus this one. Similarly, an atom in this energy level, it will go to the ground state by emitting a photon of energy, this minus this. So you can see that the photons which are emitted, they are emitted of different energies, or you can say of different frequencies. So in the emission process also, the photons which are emitted, they also have a range of frequencies. Therefore, the atom does not absorb or emit radiation of monochromatic wavelength. As we discussed in the previous lecture, we said that atom absorbs a photon of a particular wavelength, or you can say particular frequency. So atom does not absorb, due to this principle, as we have seen, there is a spread in energy, and due to this reason, the atom does not absorb or emit radiation of monochromatic wavelength, or you can say single frequency, when it makes transition from one energy level to another. So when atom goes from one energy level to another, or in the reverse process, it goes from this energy level to this one. So during this transition, the atom does not absorb or emit radiation of single frequency. So atom emits or absorbs radiation over range of frequencies. So these atoms, they absorb or they emit the photons of range of frequencies. In other words, we can say that the spectrum of a transition is not a sharp line. The spectrum of a transition, or you can say the photons which are emitted, they have a certain frequency. So that frequency is not a single frequency, but we get a range of frequencies. So spectrum of a transition is not a sharp line of a definite frequency. So it is not a sharp line. Sharp line means definite frequency, but it has some distribution over the range of frequencies. So the spectrum of a transition is not a sharp line, but has some distribution over the range of frequencies. As I have shown in this diagram, on the y-axis I have the intensity of the light which is emitted. So here I'm talking about the emission process. So if I have a two-level oscillator, so if I draw sharp lines, so this is the ground state and this is the excited state. So if I draw a perfectly sharp line, then an atom in the excited state, it will go to the ground state by emission of a photon of a certain specific frequency. Similarly, another atom will also emit a photon of same frequency. But in actual practice, the energy level, excited energy level, is not perfectly sharp, but there is a spread in energy. So this is the excited state and this is the ground state. So atom can be present over here, it can be present over here, or it can be present over here. So that is, an atom can have this much energy, or it can have this much energy, or it can have this much energy. So this is the direction in which the energy is increasing. So this atom, when it will go to the ground state, it will emit a photon of certain frequency. Then another atom, which is just above the first atom, so this atom, when it will make a transition to the ground state, it will emit a photon of a bit more frequency, as the energy difference for this atom, for this transition, is more as compared to the previous one. Similarly, this atom, when it will go to the ground state, it will emit a photon of some another frequency. So there is a range of frequency that exists in the emission process. So when you will examine these photons, when you will find out the intensity corresponding to these photons, you will see that at a certain frequency, at certain frequency nu naught, the intensity is maximum, means more number of photons are emitted at a certain frequency. So ideally, what must be the case? Ideally, we must have a graph like this. So this is the intensity and here is the frequency. So at nu is equal to nu zero, which is the central frequency, at this frequency we must have maximum intensity, and other than this frequency the intensity must be equal to zero if we are considering this case. Photons are emitted of single frequency only in this case. Therefore, the graph must look like this. The spectrum must look like this. But in actual practice, we have seen that there is a spread in energy. Due to this, the photons which are emitted, they are not of a single frequency, but there exists a range of frequencies. Therefore, the graph that we draw of intensity versus the frequency looks something like this. So at central frequency we get the maximum intensity, but other than the central frequency the intensity is not zero, it is non-zero. The intensity at frequencies other than nu zero is not equal to zero. So you can see at this frequency we have certain intensity, at this frequency also we have certain intensity, and similar is the case for these frequencies. So you can see that there is a range of frequencies that exists in the spectrum. So spectrum of a transition is not a sharp line. So it is not a sharp line, but it has some distribution over the range of frequencies. Now during the absorption process, so this is the emission process that I have drawn. So similar thing happens in the case of absorption process also. So if I talk about absorption, and if I take the ideal case of two sharp energy levels, so the excited state drawn over here is also perfectly sharp. So if I talk about the absorption process, so let's say this is the atom, this is another atom in the ground state, this is another atom. And let's say if I have various photons of different frequencies which are falling on this system, on this two level oscillator. So these atoms, they will absorb only those photons whose energy matches to this energy difference only. So this you already know, this concept you already know from the quantum mechanics, that these atoms, they will absorb only those photons whose energy matches with this energy difference. So let's say if this photon has an energy equal to, let's say this is E2 and this is E1. So energy difference is equal to E2 minus E1. So let's say this photon has energy E2 minus E1. So only this photon will be absorbed by these atoms. Other photons, they will be emitted as it is. So in the spectrum of absorption, so what do we get in the spectrum of absorption? So let's say if you have range of frequencies. So here I have drawn only three photons of different frequencies. So let's say if you have a continuous distribution of frequencies which are falling on this atom, on this system. So there is a continuous spectrum of photons which are falling on this two level oscillator. So from that continuous range of frequencies, only one particular frequency will be absorbed by these atoms. As this energy level is a sharp level and this is also a sharp energy level, so only the photons with energy E2 minus E1 will be absorbed. All other photons, they will be transmitted, they will go as it is, they will not be absorbed. So this is the ideal case, that only one photon That is only a photon of a single frequency will be absorbed. So what should we get in the spectrum? So if I'm drawing intensity versus, the frequency, you will see that at all the frequencies, the photons are emitted as it is. So the photons of these frequencies are emitted as it is, so their intensity will remain, the intensity will be non-zero. But when frequency is equal to nu zero, and nu zero is nothing but equal to, what is nu zero? So h nu zero, which is the energy of the photon which is absorbed, so this energy is exactly equal to E2 minus E1. So this is the central frequency. Now when a photon of this much energy is made to fall on this system, that photon will be absorbed. So in the emission process, or you can say if you look at the you are not looking at the emission process, this is just the absorption process, and you are just looking at the photons that go as it is out of the system, which are going out of the system. So these are the photons which we are making to fall on the system, and we are examining the photons which go out of this system. So when you will examine these photons, you will get a spectrum. So you will see that the photons of these frequencies, they are made to go as it is. So they go as it is. So we have non-zero intensity of those photons. But only at nu is equal to nu zero, only at central frequency, the photons, no photons are present. So if you look at the photons which are emitted or which are coming out of this system, you will see that the photons of this frequencies are not present, because the photons of this much frequencies have been absorbed. So the spectrum must look like this, that at all other frequencies you have a non-zero intensity, but at the central frequency the intensity goes to zero, and after that there is a sharp increase, and again at other frequencies the intensity is again non-zero. So this is an ideal graph that we must obtain when we are looking at sharp energy levels. But in actual practice, as we know that the energy levels, these are not sharp, but there is a spread in energy. So there is a spread in energy. So in actual practice, the absorption spectrum looks like this. So here we have drawn the transmitted light as a function of frequencies. So there is not a sharp, dip in the spectrum, but in actual there is a range of frequencies at which the photons are absorbed. So this graphs represent that photons of a specific frequency are only absorbed, but due to the spread in energy of the excited energy levels, we get a graph something like this. So you can see that at central frequency nu naught, the intensity is minimum, whereas at other frequencies, the intensity is less, though it is not minimum, but it is less than the maximum intensity. And some other frequencies in this region, they will have maximum intensity. So the photons with this much frequency, are also absorbed. Therefore, their intensity has decreased. And similar is the case on the other side of central frequency. So this is the absorption spectrum. So during the absorption process, interaction of the radiation with an atom is a function of frequency. So you can clearly see that in this absorption process, the interaction of the radiation is a function of frequency. So let's say if you make photons of this much energy, of this much frequency, if you make photons of this much frequency to fall on this system, then these atoms, they will not absorb those photons. So if you are making photons of this much frequency to fall on this system, these atoms, they will not absorb and those photons will be transmitted as it is. Therefore, we get a maximum intensity over here of the transmitted light. But if you make photons of this much frequency of nu is equal to nu zero to fall on this system, those photons will be absorbed. As you can see that at this much frequency, we have minimum intensity of light which is transmitted. And if you make photons of this much frequency to fall on this system, then you can see that the intensity of the transmitted light at this much frequency has decreased. Means some photons have been absorbed by this system. Some photons of this much frequency have been absorbed by this system. So this means that the interaction of radiation with an atom is a function of frequency of radiation. So at this frequency, the radiations are not absorbed. At this frequency, the maximum number of photons are absorbed. At this frequency, some of the photons are absorbed. So it is a function of frequency. And if you draw a graph of absorption coefficient, so we will look at the absorption coefficient in the next lecture. So if we talk about the absorption coefficient and frequency, so you will see that at the central frequency, the medium has maximum absorption coefficient. So at central frequency, as we know that at central frequency, the transmitted light has minimum intensity. So most of the photons at this frequency are absorbed. Therefore, transmitted light has minimum intensity at this much frequency. So this means that the medium has absorbed most of the photons at nu zero frequency, which means that absorption coefficient of the medium is maximum at central frequency. And it is not zero at other frequencies, as we say. Due to the spread in the energy, the absorption coefficient of the medium is not zero other than the central frequency. As you can see that at this frequency, the medium shows certain absorption coefficient, though this is less as compared to the maximum absorption coefficient which is shown at the central frequency. So at this frequency, it shows a certain absorption coefficient. At this frequency, it shows a bit more absorption coefficient, and so on. So this is the graph that I have drawn of absorption coefficient versus frequency. So it is represented by k nu. So absorption coefficient is represented by k nu, and this means that it is a function of frequency. As you can see that it is a function of frequency. When the photon has frequency nu zero, then most of the photons will be absorbed. That is, the absorption coefficient will be maximum. So we can see that the interaction of the radiation with an atom is a function of frequency of the radiation. So it is a function of frequency. And this function is called as the line shape function. So this function is termed as line shape function, and it is represented by G omega in most of the books, and in some books it is represented by G nu. So this is the line shape function. So this absorption coefficient is a function of frequency. So it is a function of frequency, it is related to frequency. And this line shape function is a normalized function. Normalized function, functions you have already done in quantum mechanics, that how do we normalize a function. So this line shape function is a normalized function, means G nu d nu. So G nu means it is a function of frequency. So G nu into d nu from minus infinity to plus infinity should be equal to 1. So this is the meaning of a normalized function, that its integration from minus infinity to plus infinity must be equal to 1. So this line shape function is a normalized function. Now here this is d nu. So it is a frequency interval. And we know that frequency cannot be negative. So frequency cannot be negative, so this function can be changed to 0 to infinity. So frequency cannot be negative, so this can be changed to this integration into g nu into d nu as it is equal to 1. So this is a line shape function and it is a normalized function.